بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين أما بعد Esteemed علماء, honored elders, brothers, mothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته All praise be unto Allah سبحانه وتعالى who continuously showers us with his countless favors and bounties on a daily basis. And for that we are ever grateful to Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala and ever hopeful that Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala never restricts and takes away those bounties from us as we are in need of Him, but He is not in need of us Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. On this beautiful day we send salutations and greetings to the best of creation, Muhammadur Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala ali Muhammad, kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka hamidun majid. Under the current circumstances and situations that we find ourselves in, we have obviously been limited in many ways. And among the many ways that we have been restricted and limited is relating to the beautiful day of Jumu'ah. Many of us are accustomed to walking into the masjid and experiencing or going through a Jumu'ah talk, perhaps leaving the masjid feeling a bit inspired. And now with the current situation that we find ourselves in and the situation that the entire world is currently facing, that obviously has created a vacuum and a void in that we are now deprived of that opportunity of coming into the masjid and listening to a talk, listening to the advices of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, listening to the noble Quran being recited. And we hope and pray that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala can return us to the masjid safely and return us to the masjid as soon as possible in order for us to experience the beautiful month of Ramadan, which we know is but a few weeks away. So in order to try and fill in that bit of a gap before the Jumu'ah khutbah, if many of us will be performing the Jumu'ah khutbah and salah in our respective homes or areas, and if not, then the Dhuhr salah that we will be performing individually or perhaps with two other people, we have this opportunity to try and listen once again to the advices of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and to listen to the explanation of certain verses of the Quran that are very much related to once again the crisis that we are facing, not only as a Muslim ummah but humanity at large. When we look at the verse of Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala provides us with a solution to the problem that we are currently facing. And we know that apart from the direct solution, that definitely Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent down with the sickness, with this virus that is spreading like wildfire. In the true words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala does not send down a sickness and illness, except that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends down the cure for it as well. We perhaps are just still on the road to discovering that particular cure. But Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala provides us with another beautiful way of seeking His assistance. And Allah says, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, O those who believe, ista'inu, seek the assistance of Allah bis-sabri was-salah, via the avenues of patience and salah. Inna Allaha ma'as-sabirin, surely Allah is with those who bear patience. Now when we look at the verse, we will look at it in totality. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, O believers. So in order for us to really benefit from this verse, and in order for us to really see the fruition of this verse in our lives, we need to become proper believers. We need to become the best believers that we can possibly be. And part of the belief system of a mu'min, of a Muslim, is that he or she believes that everything is in the control of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sometimes we tend to get carried away with the spreading of this virus, with the transmission of this illness. And in our statements that we utter, at times we tend to take Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala out of the equation. And yes, we understand that contagion is a reality. Contagion is something true. However, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam has also taught us to strike the middle path. And that is la tīrata, that there is no contagion except with that which Allah wishes to pass from person to person, except that type of a transmission that only Allah is in control of. So I will not be able to transmit a virus from myself to another person by touching his hand or her hand, and nor will I be able to contract that verse by walking past a person that is sneezing or coughing, except if Allah wants it to be transmitted to the next person, except if Allah wants me to contract that particular illness or virus. So once we understand that Allah is in full control and we bring the iman and the reality and the belief of that into our lives, now we can proceed with the verse, Ista'inu, seek the assistance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's a very lovely subtlety in this verse, and that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling unto us as a collective unit. Amanu ista'inu. For those who appreciate the Arabic language, you will know that this is in the plural form. That as a collective unit, O believers, O ummah of Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we need to collectively and as one unit seek the assistance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if we are bickering and fighting about trivial issues that may not even affect us on a daily basis, then we will never be able to really seek the assistance of Allah and gain the assistance of Allah Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal. So once we are on the same page and we are collectively seeking the assistance of Allah, now we can once again move forward. How do we seek the assistance of Allah? Bis-sabri was-salah, with patience, with forbearance, and with salah. Now we know salah to be one of the most integral parts of belief and one of the most integral parts of a Muslim's life. One of the first things that he or she will be questioned on the day of Qiyamah as to, how did you look after your salah? How did you perform your salah? How many salah did you miss out? These will be the types of questions that a person will face on the day of Qiyamah. So we can understand the severity and the importance of salah and the severity of missing one's salah. However, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala in this verse gives preference of sabr over to salah. And this is shown once again when Allah says, Inna Allaha ma'as sabireen. Surely the help and the assistance of Allah will be with those who are patient people. Allah did not say, Inna Allaha ma'al musalleen. Whilst that may be true in its own right as well, that Allah's assistance and help and mercy will be with those who perform salah. But if we are using our salah to seek assistance from Allah, we need to ensure that we have our sabr intact as well, our patience intact as well. It's pointless performing salah, reciting multiple Quran khatams, and sending abundant of durood and salutations to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, seeking Allah's forgiveness in the multitudes, when we don't have patience at the same time. We should remember that a test from Allah is to test whether or not we are still reliant upon Allah's help even through the most difficult of moments. Whether we accept the fact that this is a test from Allah and the relief is also going to come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Thereafter, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains, وَلَا تَقُولُوا لِمَنْ يُقْتَلُ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أَمْوَاتٍ بَلْ أَحْيَاءٌ وَلَكِنْ لَا تَشْعُرُونَ. We need to understand that the meaning of the Noble Quran is not restricted to one particular era, one particular time. It is for the entirety of time and it is for all of mankind. The meaning of the Quran applies and resonates throughout history and for the time to come as well throughout the future. There is no time limit to the Quran. There is no restriction that no, this verse only applies to that particular time when it was revealed. Yes, the verse may have been revealed at a particular time for a particular moment related to a particular Sahabi. It might be the case. However, the lesson is for us till today and for the future generations to come as well. So Allah says that do not call those who have passed away and sacrificed their lives in the path of Allah, do not call them dead, do not call them deceased, because they are surely alive, however you and I cannot perceive. How amazing is it that at this very moment when this crisis has struck the world, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said in a hadith that any person whose life is taken during a plague, during a mass illness or sickness, then that person will achieve the daraja and the stage, the status of a shaheed, of one who has passed away in the path of Allah, the status of a martyr. So once again, the meaning of the verse is resonating that any person who has passed away and has succumbed to this particular virus, that is not the be all and end all. And this ought to really settle us and put us at ease as Muslims, that we shouldn't fear death. Death is something that is feared by almost every person. But as a mu'min and as a Muslim, we know very well that death isn't the end part. Death is the beginning of the next journey and the eternal journey, the eternal life in Jannah. May Allah make us from among the Jannatees. Ameen ya Rabbal Alameen. So death is once again just that passing point. It is that transit period. It is that lounge that we are in. And yes, we can make it a lounge by turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it will not be something strenuous upon a believer if we are in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and following the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Thereafter, Allah says, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ. And we will certainly test you with a fragment, bi shay'in, with one portion, with a small part of jur, or rather of khawf. Allah says, we will test you with fear. And we know that prior to the lockdown, each one of us were fearing to even leave our homes. We were fearing perhaps even meeting the neighbor. We were fearing even a family member coming home. And now even in the lockdown, when we need to go out and retrieve our essential items, we will still have that fear. And with that fear, obviously comes the face masks, the hand gloves, the sanitizers, etc. We take our precautionary measures because we have that fear. So Allah says, we will test you with that fear. And currently we are experiencing that fear. Wal-ju'i, we will test you with a fragment of hunger. We know that prior to the lockdown, what the supermarkets were looking like, that people couldn't even fathom the thought of hunger, never mind actually experiencing a bit of hunger, but we couldn't even fathom the thought of hunger. That is why we stood in long queues to buy 10 and 20 amounts of baked beans, and we bought lots of things that perhaps we wouldn't even eat on a daily basis, but we bought it in order to consume it, because we couldn't understand and we couldn't fathom just the thought of hunger. Allah says, we will test you with it, and people are being tested with it today. وَنَقْصٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْوَالِ, and we will test you by decreasing your wealth, with a deficiency in your wealth, from the micro level to the macro level of businesses and sectors, to the great economies of the world and the economies of the superpowers of the world. Every person is feeling the pinch in their pockets. Every person is feeling the pinch in their pockets. Why? For the deficiency of wealth, we know that people are reliant on business. And in the lockdown, people don't have that business. Yes, certain areas and certain businesses will obviously be booming where essential services are required. But I'm speaking on a general level, that the economies are facing that downfall. وَنَقْصٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْوَالِ, we will test you with that as well. وَالْأَنفُسِ, we will test you with the deficiency in souls as well. We know that people are also succumbing to their wounds and to the virus itself. People are losing their lives. وَالْأَنفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ, we will test you with fruits. Now fruits can either mean actual and literal fruits, the fruits of any season, or it can mean anything that you put effort in and expect a good result to come thereof. So a person spent his first few months of the year, or perhaps the greater portion of the end of last year, working and toiling to try and make that extra profit so that in June or the July holidays of this year, he or she could be on a plane somewhere flying to an exotic destination and enjoying the fruits of his hard work. However, we don't even know if we are going to be reaching such a point as a holiday. Rather, it will be maybe still a time that there will still be restriction in movement. But more so, every person, once we return back to our normal lives, it's not going to be as normal as it were before. We will test you. Thereafter, Allah says once again, وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ, give glad tidings to those people and that group of people that have patience, that have forbearance, that are still going through their everyday tests and trials with Allah in their minds and with Allah in their hearts, with the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam at bay. So once again, وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ, not even وَبَشِّرِ الْمُصَلِّينَ, even though those that perform salah are definitely given glad tidings and reward by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who are the people that bear patience? الَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُصِيبًا, those people whom any difficulty may afflict them, قَالُوا إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ, they do not waste a second. Immediately their response is, Inna lillahi, we are for Allah, wa inna ilayhi raji'un, and to Allah is our ultimate return. Ulaika alayhim salawatun min rabbihim wa rahma. This group of people, they will ultimately have the blessings and the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wa ulaika hum al-muhtadun, and undoubtedly they will be from among the rightly guided people. So once we've understood what the reaction of a Muslim and a mu'min needs to be at this time, at this crucial time of crisis, we can now understand and appreciate the advices of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in relation to a lockdown. And this is what we will ultimately end off with, is how Islam so beautifully portrays the idea of a person's home being his kingdom. A person's home being his kingdom. We might call it a lockdown, we might call it a shutdown, and in reality it actually might be that. But for a believer that will listen to the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and take it to heart, for that believer, this is not a lockdown, or this is not a deprivation of any kind. Rather, this is once again Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam telling us that this is part of your kingdom. Once Sayyiduna Uqba bin Amir radiallahu anhu met with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he asked him that, O Nabi of Allah, man najatu, what is salvation, what is a true savior? And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam responded, Ya Uqba, O Uqba, amlik alayka lisanak, have control over your tongue, have control over your speech, wal yasa'ka baytuk, and let your house be spacious for you. Let your house be a kingdom for you. Let your house be a sanctuary and a haven for you. وَبَكِ عَلَىٰ خَطِيئَتِكَ, and cry over any evil and any wrongdoing from your side. Cry and lament over your evil actions. But the important part, وَلْيَسَعَكَ بَيْتُكَ, in this context, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is explaining to Uqba that you want to know what true salvation is. Salvation lies in your home. Not just salvation from a virus, but salvation from sin, salvation from engaging in backbiting, salvation in a way that now you have an opportunity to interact with the people that actually matter the most to you in your life, to interact and be good and kind to the people as an act of charity, as we will allude to in a short while. In another hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells us, "As-safaru qit'atun min al-'adhab." Traveling is actually a portion of adhab, it is a portion of punishment. How so? يَمْنَعُ أَحَدَكُمْ نَوْمَهُ وَطَعَامَهُ وَشَرَابَهُ, that traveling prevents a person from his regular sleep, whether it is a regular sleep pattern or his regular and comfortable sleep that he would have got in his own and comfortable bed. وَطَعَامَهُ, it prevents a person from the food that he is usually accustomed to and something that his palate is used to. وَشَرَابَهُ, it prevents a person from the usual drink that he or she would have when he or she was home. فَإِذَا قَضَى أَحَدُكُمْ نَهْمَتَهُ مِنْ وَجْهِهِ, that if any one of you were to travel and you once complete your action, whatever it is you went out for, you complete the purpose of travel, whatever you traveled for, فَلْيُعَجِّلْ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهِ, let him hasten to his home, let him hasten to his family. Once again, that is his sanctuary, that is his haven. It's rather ironic that when we would be going out to work, and when we were in the rat race of everyday life, we were hoping that we could just have that weekend extended just one more day. Whenever it came to Sunday night, you would see the glum faces of our children at home, and you would see the glum faces of the youngsters knowing that the next day is school, and you would see the irritated face perhaps of the husband knowing that the next day he has to now go back to the work, or perhaps the wife that the next day is once again back to my routine, back to work again. And you would hope that if only that weekend could be extended one bit. So when we were outdoors, we wanted to be indoors. But now that we have a lockdown and now that we only have the walls of our homes surrounding us, we now feel the urge and the need and the desire to once again go out there. Now we want to go back to work. Isn't it rather ironic? Now our focus in these last few moments is, what can a mu'min do during a lockdown? Something, what will be of benefit for that mu'min during a lockdown? Firstly, in order to spend our time fruitfully at home, we, each of us, ought to set a routine of activities and things that we need to do and want to do at home. The minute we just leave things out in the open and okay, I'll just go with the day as the days come and I'll just do whatever comes to my mind at that point, that is definitely not beneficial to the person. Once you set out a routine, you can sit down, put a timetable together. You can say that, okay, my morning portion I'll spend like this, the afternoon I'll spend like this, the evening I will spend it in this way. You have that routine and you follow up and you try and fulfill it to the best of your ability. This will ensure some fruitful time being spent during a lockdown. Secondly, we are experiencing the beautiful month of Sha'ban. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would extend and he would capitalize on this month of Sha'ban by extending his fasting. He would intensify his fasting during the month of Sha'ban as a preparatory method for the month of Ramadan, in order to ready himself for the month of Ramadan. We are at home. Some may feel that you're at home now, you actually start eating a bit more because now you have availability, you have the snacks that are available and at your disposal at all time. However, we need to capitalize on it in the other way, by using this month of Sha'ban to gain closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and following the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by also fasting as much as we can. Because now we perhaps can now take a nap at any time during the day and we maybe won't be exerting ourselves as much as we would do when we are fasting, and that would obviously consume less energy. So it would be ideal for us to start fasting as much as possible before the month of Ramadan. Thirdly, it is high time for us to turn our houses into homes. Allah says in the Quran, وَاللَّهُ جَعَلَ لَكُم مِّن بُيُوتِكُمْ سَكَنًا, and Allah has made your houses a place and a means of tranquility, a place of peace. Allah has made your houses into homes. Allah has given you the ability of turning your houses into homes. Our homes needs to be a place of tranquility, as Allah has stated in the Quran already. That is the purpose of a home. It is a place where you need to achieve serenity, where you need to achieve your inner peace. So how do we turn our houses into homes? Once again, following the guidelines of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In one hadith, Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam had said, "Rahim Allahu imra'an," may Allah have mercy upon that man who wakes up in the dead of night. He relieves himself, and thereafter he uses the miswak, he makes his wudu, and there before turning to prayer and turning to salah before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he goes to his wife and he wakes her up. She'll wake up in the early parts of the night, she'll say, it's 2 o'clock in the morning, what are we doing? And he'll say that, let us turn to Allah together. Let us perform our salah together. Let us perform tahajjud together and ask from the treasures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Similarly, may Allah have mercy upon that wife as well, who does the same thing, wakes her husband up in the dead of night so that they may seek from the bounties and treasures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In a time where perhaps we are restricted also from giving out as much charity as we would perhaps give before, maybe giving out food or hampers or whatever it is, we are now restricted because of the movement and because of the lockdown, we still look toward other acts of charity. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had told us that an act of charity extends to the point of a man placing a morsel of food into the mouth of his wife. This is an act of charity. And we know that charity is something that extinguishes the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, something that we are in need of in this time that we are facing. So place a morsel of food in the mouth of your spouse when you are having meals at home. We should remember that as a married couple, we don't show lust to our children. We don't show the lust between husband and wife to our children, but we should show them the love between husband and wife. And this is an ideal moment for a child to look that this is how my father treats my mother. So as a man, when I grow up, when I get married, I will treat my wife in the same way. Similarly, a daughter will grow up believing that if my mother treated her husband in this way, I will treat my husband in this beautiful way as well. Another fruitful thing that we can do during this lockdown is set aside some time to read as a family. Set aside some time to read as a family, whether it's picking up an Islamic history book or a hadith book, something that we can read as a family, that we can take benefit from as a family. You let every person in the house have a chance to read, and it doesn't have to go on for hours. Even if it is just for 10, 15, 20 minutes a day, let us read as a family in order to equip ourselves with sufficient Islamic knowledge to go through our daily lives, not only now, but even afterwards. And now we make an appeal to the men of the Ummah, of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to assist in the household chores, to assist in the household activities, whether it is cooking, whether it is cleaning, whether it is the washing or the ironing, whether it is packing cupboards, whatever it is. As a man, it is now time for us at being at home. Now we are at home, we don't have any excuses. So whatever it is our wives had asked us to do months ago, and we said, I don't have the time, unfortunately, I can't give you an excuse now. So now you have to get on that step ladder and fix up that light bulb that you've been meaning to fix for such a long while. When Sayyidatuna Aisha radiallahu anha was asked as to the actions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at home, she replied that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam assisted in the household chores to the extent that even for his own things that he needed to see to, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would even patch up and mend his own clothing. If there was a hole in his garment, he would patch it up himself. This is the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Any person, any man who thinks that it is beyond me or it is below me to assist in the household chores, that is not the way of our Nabi. We claim to follow that Nabi, then we ought to follow him as much as possible. Another item that we could do as a family together, we can exercise as a family together. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was passing through an area with his beloved wife Aisha radiallahu anha, and when they came to a certain point, they ran a race together. And at that point, Aisha radiallahu anha had beat Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sometime later, when they were passing through that point again, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells Aisha radiallahu anha, it's time for a rematch. And when they ran that race, it was some years later, so Aisha radiallahu anha had become a little bit slow. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam beat her. Afterwards, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that this victory is for my defeat the last time. So it is part of the sunnah once again to exercise as a family, to do it as a family unit. Something else that we can do for recreational purposes, we can play some board games that stimulate our thinking capacity as well, or we can even turn something educational into something fun. Another thing that we can do is to take benefit from the senior citizens and the elderly and the more experienced that are living in our household as well. We should remember that those from previous generations, their home, they took it as their kingdom. They took it as their sanctuary. They took it as their resting place and their peaceful place. They perhaps did not go out as much as you and I. They perhaps did not go out to malls and restaurants as much as you and I. And that is the beauty of how they had lived their lives, that they took their homes as Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave the advice to Uqbah radiallahu anhu, wal yasa'ka baytuk. Make your house spacious for you. Make your house a haven for you. Make your house a fun place for you as well. So let us turn to them. Let us turn to our more experienced members of our family. And let us listen to what they did in their past as well for recreational purposes. How did they live in their homes? Let us learn from their experiences. It is something for us to really take to. As the Arabic proverb says, سَلِ الْمُجَرَّبْ لَا تَسْأَلِ الْحَكِيمِ. Ask the experienced person, don't ask the one who thinks he knows it all also. And finally, most importantly, this is a time for self-reformation. It is a time for self-reflection, a time for us to gain closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We need to remember That part of the reason as to why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends a calamity down to people is because of the actions of those people. ظهر الفساد في البر والبحر بما كسبت أيدي الناس. That corruption, havoc, chaos will become manifest on the earth, and it will become manifest in the seas because of the actions that people commit as well. We are not blaming, we are not putting the blame on any particular person or on the people at large. That yes, it is because of the people's fault that is why Allah had sent this virus to us. No, Allah has also sent the virus as a mercy to the believers. But we need to also take stock of our actions, and this is an ideal time to do so. A time for self-reformation, a time for self-reflection, that what perhaps it may have been something that I have done. We know the famous hadith of Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam, when the people of his area were afflicted with a drought. The people got together and they, as a collective unit, they started to pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, performing istisqa, that, oh Allah, we need your assistance and we need you to send rain to our barren lands. And at that point, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had informed Musa alayhi salam that there is a person from among you that needs to make tawbah. There is a person from among you that has committed certain grave actions in his life, and he needs to turn to me. That is the reason why I am withholding the rain. So Musa alayhi salam proclaims and makes the exclamation to his people that there is someone from among us that needs to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in repentance for certain actions that he has committed. And at that point, nobody had come forth. After a short while, immediately it started to rain. So Musa alayhi salam had asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that, oh Allah, you had withheld the rain because of the actions of a certain person, and I made the call, nobody came forward. How is it that the rain started flowing thereafter? And Allah said that I did not expose him when I was withholding the rain, so I will not expose him now when I am sending the rain down as well. But you should know that he had made a sincere tawbah. He had made a sincere repentance, such a repentance that had moved me to now send the rain down. So we need to now turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in repentance for certain actions that we may have committed in our lives. A time of reflection, a time of reformation, a time of repentance. Something that we need to do on a daily basis, whether there is an affliction that comes or not. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and I will end off with this, that what happens once this lockdown has passed and once inshallah this virus has been contained and the numbers start to decrease. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam had said that it is amazing, the matter of a mu'min is really amazing. When he goes through difficulty, he has patience. And when he experiences bliss, when he experiences ease, he is grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are another two qualities that we ought to bring into our lives, as we had said in the beginning, that وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَ الصَّابِرِينَ. May Allah make us from among the patient ones, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from among the thankful ones. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to remove this virus completely from not only the ummah of Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but from humanity at large. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allow us to become fruitful during this time of lockdown. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala strengthen the bonds that we have with our family members. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect our homes from the works of shaitan and his cronies. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.